Hello everybody, I am Piyush Madan and I welcome you all. Many of you might be confused regarding which optional to choose. You have decided about pursuing your dream for becoming an IAS officer. However, the aspect related to the optional still remains unclear. In this video of mine, I intend to discuss a little bit about this aspect from the point of view of PSIR as an optional. Is PSIR an optional for you? Or what optional one should choose? What should be the considerations while you choose an optional? Should an optional be chosen only out of certain interest? For example, let's say you have pursued an engineering subject in your graduation. So should you pursue that engineering subject or should you change your subject? How has been the success rate or the performance of the particular subject in the previous few years? What is the overlap with the general studies? And finally, what is the guidance material available? What should be the considerations which you take into account while choosing an optional? Let me try to decipher that for you. Factors to consider while choosing an optional. Now, any optional you choose, any optional, these four should be the considerations which you take in mind. The interest in the subject, the success rate of the subject, the overlap with the general studies and the guidance material, the availability of that particular aspect. For example, if I talk about the interest in the subject. Many of you coming from the humanities background have an interest in the humanities subject. You would want to go for sociology, PSIR, public administration, these kinds of subjects. For others of you who are from the management background, they would want to pursue, let's say, commerce as their optional or management as their optional. For those coming from the engineering background, they might want to pursue physics as their background or chemistry as their background or mathematics as their background. So interest in the subject remains paramount because you have to stay with the subject for a period of 1.5 to 2 years. So the interest in the subject remains important and one of the foremost considerations while choosing an optional. I'll discuss what PSIR is from the perspective of the academic study so that you can analyze for yourself if you have an interest in such kind of questions, in such kinds of debates, in such kind of academic discussions. Second is the success rate, how the subject has been doing, how the subject has been doing in the last, let's say, 5 to 6 years. It's a good frame of reference to study. This will give us a good idea whether the subject is scoring or not. Although such considerations should not be taken as a first priority or as I would say the topmost priorities, because the success rate eventually will depend on how much effort you put in. In spite of that, we will look at the success rate of the subject also. Third, which I consider is also a very important factor, is the overlap with the general studies. Now, the overlap with the general studies makes your optional and the general studies preparation an integrated one, and hence whatever optional you choose, that will give you a strategic edge if there is a huge overlap with the general studies. The concepts which you study in the optional can very well be incorporated in the general studies, and a lot of concepts from the general studies, if they you are actually able to put them in your optionals, then I would say that's a very strategic choice, and this will be something which will help you a lot in the long run. See, the examination is like a marathon, it's not a sprint. You'll have to keep running for a lot of time. So having a plan, having a strategy is what differentiates a winner from a loser. And you know, you have to take these considerations into account while choosing an optional. So the overlap with general studies, I would say, is a very important consideration. The fourth is the guidance material, the availability of the guidance material. What kind of resources are available? Are the resources available sufficient? Are they accessible? These all considerations should also be taken into account while you choose your optional. Now let me discuss each of these considerations from the viewpoint of political science and international relations. The first being the interest in the subject. Now the point is, give me a minute, what is the subject? PSIR as a subject. I'll give you a brief introduction about that. We have two aspects, political science aspect and the international relations aspect. Now, these two aspects I'll discuss separately to give you an overview about the subject. When I talk about political science, then I am talking about the scientific manner in which, let's say, power is occupied. The scientific manner in which, let's say, the Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi, captured power and is running the state. Or for that matter, the previous prime ministers, or for that matter, the political parties, how they capture power and sit in that position where they can run the state. What is the scientific way in which this study is done? Political science ko kaha jata hai rajniti vigyan. Kis tarike se logon ko mobilize kiya jata hai? Caste is one consideration on the basis of which you mobilize people. Aap logon ko ikattha karte hain caste ke basis pe, or religion ke basis pe, or language ke basis pe, or there can be other ascriptive factors also. So all the basis of all these factors, I am mobilizing people, main logon ko ikattha kar raha hu, aur power ko capture karne ke liye ye log meri madad kar rahe hain. So the scientific study of this aspect is what political science is about. Let's say I take the example of democracy. It's a relatively new concept to India, barring those times whereby there was democracy in India during the, let's say, the Cholas time, or there were certain small intervals where we see democratic traditions in India. In the modern sense of the word democracy, we see now India being a democratic state. So what this democracy is all about? Is it only about the procedures? Is it only about you going out and giving let's say vote? Or are there higher dimensions to democracy also? Whether democracy is only procedural or democracy is substantive also? Democracy as a political ideal, this is something which I'll study here. Similarly, what is justice? Nyay kya hai? Nyay hai kya? Kya nyay ye hai ki mujhe disadvantageous section ko reservation deni hai? Some people will say yes, this is justice, but the others will say no, this is not justice. However, India's constitution recognizes this principle and we have given reservation. This, it's an affirmative action. So nyay kya hota hai, justice hota kya hai? Let's say I talk about equality. It's a relatively new concept. Ancient times mein it was believed that people are not equal. The thinkers like Plato, Aristotle, they believed in natural inequality. Log by birth unequal hai. India mein hierarchy hai. We have the caste system in India, it is hierarchical. So inequality was the norm. Equality is something which is new. And if I have to say so, equality between men and women is even new. It's a more relative concept. equality as a political ideal, if I talk about, I'll see in political science. Then if I talk about the origin of the state, state aayi kahan se? Manu Smriti mein likha hai, Manu is the first king. He is the lawgiver. And the king has derived his authority from the god. So we say it's a divine origin of the state. When I talk about king, I mean state. तो जो ओरिजिन ऑफ स्टेट है वो डिवाइन है, वो भगवान ने बनाई है स्टेट. और इफ आई टेक यू टू द मॉडर्न टाइम्स, मैन आई से मॉडर्न टाइम्स 500 years back, द फिलोसफी ऑफ रेनेसा केम, द अनलॉकिंग ऑफ ह्यूमन माइंड स्टार्ट्स, लिबरलिज्म एज अ फिलोसफी ग्रू. तो लिबरलिज्म की फिलोसफी कहती है नहीं, भगवान ने नहीं दिया स्टेट, हमने खुद बनाई है. सो द थ्योरी ऑफ सोशल कॉन्ट्रैक्ट कम्स इनटू बीइंग. इंसान थे, वो लोग आपस में लड़ रहे थे, दे वर फाइटिंग अमंगस्ट ईच अदर, एंड दे नीडेड एन एंटिटी सो दैट लॉ एंड ऑर्डर सिचुएशन कैन बी मेंटेन्ड एंड दे कैन लिव अ पीसफुल एंड अ हैप्पी लाइफ. इन ऑर्डर फॉर देम टू लीड अ पीसफुल एंड अ हैप्पी लाइफ, दे डेलीगेटेड सर्टन पावर्स टू एन एंटिटी एंड आस्क्ड इट टू गवर्न. And that entity was state. So state aa gayi, the theory of social contract. Ab state aa gayi to uske paas powers kitni hai, jisme aap dekhte hain yahan ladai hoti hai between the executive judiciary and the legislature. The fight between judiciary and legislature led to the origin of the doctrine of basic structure. The fight between judiciary and executive resulted in the 99th constitutional amendment, which was the National Judicial Appointments Commission. Ki judges ki niyukti executive karega, executive will have a say, but that was held unconstitutional. To wo ladai bhi chal rahi hai. Ab I have created state, I have given it powers. The executive has been given the power to administer the laws. The legislature has been given the powers to make the laws. The judiciary has been given the powers to adjudicate on the disputes. But in me bhi ladai chal rahi hai. Or if I have to say so, what is the jurisdiction of this, this and this, that remains contended. How they are helpful in running a political order, in running what we call as India, Bharat ko chalane mein, everybody is playing a role. But there are conflicts, and these conflicts lead to, I would say, you know, the democracy matures because of the conflicts also. But there are issues also. Parliament mein issue hai, judiciary ka issue hai, judicial accountability ka issue hai, judiciary ki the appointment of the judges, that is a concern. The overreach by the executive is a concern. Ab dekhte hain. Supposedly, there are so many cases whereby the people have been booked under the sedition law. But then when the cases move to judiciary, the judiciary says they do not hold merit. And there we say the executive is overreaching. Executive is police, is an executive, part of executive. So all these aspects, state ki creation ho gayi, pehle hui kaise? Then I have given the responsibilities to the state. These are responsibilities to the state, they are not powers of the state. State ka kaam raj karna nahi hai, seva karna hai, right? That is why you call civil servants are servants, because responsibility is to serve the people, not to, you know, rule the people, because power lies with the masses. So if these kinds of things interest you, then political science can be a subject for you. Now, if I take this whole discussion into the domain of the international sphere, there we have the international relations part. Stay with me. Let me raise this. Okay. Now, I have created a state. This state, it's in the domestic sphere. When I start the analysis of the state, between the states, actually, the analysis is taken into the arena whereby there are multiple states, then I enter into the arena of international relations. That I have India also, that I have China also, I have USA also and Pakistan also. Now, having states is one thing, but what will I study as a part of PSIR? That, okay, stay with me, international relations. So, I will study first of all, what are the bases on which the international relations are carried out. Dosti bhi hai, ladai bhi hai. We have friends, we have enemies. But the dictum of international politics is that there is no permanent friend and there is no permanent enemy. What is permanent is the interests. So, international relations are carried out on the basis of interests. Friendships, or being friends with a particular country, or being enemy of a particular country, that is a temporary phenomenon in international politics. There are lots of states, just like there were humans in the domestic sphere, they were fighting, they created a state to govern themselves in a better way, to lead a more peaceful and happy life. Similarly, if I take the argument to the international sphere, I have different states. I have India, and I have Pakistan, I have USA, I have China, all are again fighting amongst each other, and they also try to, you know, create harmony amongst themselves. So, they created an institution of United Nations. But United Nations is not able to prevent wars, United Nations is not able to prevent conflicts, they keep on fighting amongst themselves because of the interests. They want to capture more power. These kinds of relationships, what are the basis of these relationships? What is the consequences of relationships? What is the consequences of, let's say, two countries coming together? For example, let's say I take the example of India and USA. If they come together, they are the bonhomie between actually India and USA, it is increasing in the recent times. They are coming together to counter an adversary, a common adversary, which is China. What are the repercussions of India and USA coming together? I have India, I have USA, I have China. But on the other hand side, I have here Russia, I have Pakistan. If they are coming together, the relationships between India and China, they are also getting affected. The relationships between India and Russia, they are also getting affected. The relationships between India and Pakistan, they are getting affected because of the China coming closer to Pakistan. India-USA coming together, Russia is going away. China-Pakistan coming together, again, India having problem. It is a mesh, it is a cobweb of relations. What determines India and USA coming together? In spite of that, India is also having trade with China. What determines all these aspects? Nations aisa kyun karte hain? Power kya hoti hai? Security kya hoti hai? कोल्ड वॉर क्या थी, इंटरनेशनल पॉलिटिक्स कैसे चलती है, इंटरनेशनल इकोनॉमी क्या होती है, ऑल दीज एस्पेक्ट्स आर कवर्ड एज अ पार्ट ऑफ द इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस. टेररिज्म है, इट्स अ ग्लोबल फिनोमेना दीज डेज. हाउ डिड दिस केम इनटू बीइंग, व्हाट इज द आइडियोलॉजी ऑफ टेररिज्म, व्हाट इज यूएन डूइंग टू प्रिवेंट टेररिज्म. Similarly, you have seen North Korea threatening by nuclear, detonating nuclear devices. So, what is nuclear proliferation? India is a nuclear country, nuclear weapons state. USA is a nuclear weapons state. Pakistan is a nuclear weapons state. There are other countries which do not have nuclear weapons. the nuclear weapons might go in the hands of the asymmetric actors or the terrorists also. It's a concern. What is the whole discourse around nuclear proliferation, nuclear governance, nuclear policy of India, the no first use policy of India, the deterrence in the policy? All these aspects remain part of the international relations. So if these kinds of things interest you, then political science is a good subject for you. Let me move forward now, and let me take the discussion to the second parameter in our discussion, which was the success rate. Okay, this is an important parameter, and I would like to draw your attention towards the number, this is the number of candidates appeared, recommended over a period of year, and here is the important factor of success rate. Now, from 2014 to 2017, we are seeing the trend is increasing. The trend is increasing as in you have more number of students who have started appearing in the examination with PSIR as their optional. At the same time, with the parameter which is more important is that the number of candidates which are recommended, the number of candidates recommended finally at the end of the day, they have increased and they have become approximately doubled from 57 in 2014 to 117 in 2017. The data is taken from the UPSC annual reports available on the website of the UPSC. Success rate has gone up from 6.3% to 9.4%. So if I talk purely about the numbers, then yes, the subject is doing good. I'll give you another parameter to make things more clear to you. This is the number of students who were recommended on the final day, 117 students in 2017. Now, I don't remember the exact number of seats, but it was somewhere close to 800 in 2017, which means one out of every 8 student which got recommended in 2017 had a background of PSIR. This is a better indicator. Success rate is determined by the number of students appearing and the number of students recommended. But one out of every 8 students which got recommended, they had PSIR as their background. So this tells you in a better manner about the performance of the subject, the success rate and this parameter. The numbers are taken from the UPSC annual report. Now let me move forward. Overlap with general studies. I would say it's a very important factor, and stay with me on this one because I'll elaborate in detail where this overlap happens in general studies. One is the mains examination and the other is the personal interview stage. So, I'll discuss each of them. Now, if I talk about the mains examination, in general studies, one paper, we have history, geography and society portions. In the history portion, you study about the world history. In PSIR, we study about the Cold War and the events leading to the Cold War, as well as what happened during the Cold War and also after the Cold War. So, point being, broadly last 100-110 years are covered as a part of the study in PSIR, which directly overlaps with the world history portion of the general studies 1. Now, if I come to the society portion, this is interesting, whereby we see the role of various ascriptive identity markers like caste, religion, ethnicity, language, and we study them explicitly as the part of the PSIR's paper 1. in Indian and government, Indian government and politics part, I beg your pardon, in paper 1 of PSIR, these topics are directly mentioned, and we go in detail of these topics which have a direct overlap with the society portion of GS1. Similarly, we have globalization topic in paper 2, and that globalization is also one of the important themes in the society paper. Rather, I would say globalization is a theme which can be utilized across GS3, of GS 1, 2, 3 and 4 papers. And globalization is one of the core topics of paper 2 in PSIR. So, it's a huge overlap. Coming to geography, there is no particular direct or explicit overlap. However, recently UPSC has been asking questions in geography section which are very generic in nature, and they have a geopolitical context. So, the geopolitical context can be written well by a PSIR student. Having said that, it would not be wrong if I go to the extent of saying that you can easily have an overlap of 60 to 70 marks in General Studies 1 from the PSIR paper. Moving ahead, GS2. Now, GS2 is essentially a paper which is studied in detail in PSIR. PSIR is divided into two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. In paper 1, we have the Indian government and politics part, which is nothing but General Studies 2 paper of the mains examination. The topics like Indian polity, Indian constitution, the working of the Indian parliament, the working of the Indian judiciary, the issues around the executive, these all are syllabus for GS2 as well as for the PSIR direct overlap. Similarly, in GS2, we have the international relations, which forms a very important part of the syllabus because of the weightage given to it. Every year, somewhere around 50 to 60 marks, it can extend to even 70 to 80 marks, are asked from the international sphere. The questions from the international sphere carry this much weightage in General Studies 2 paper, which again can be easily answered by a PSIR student, because in paper 2 we study the international relations extensively. Rest in GS2 remains the governance and the social justice portion, which do not have any overlap with the PSIR. However, in spite of that, you can easily have an overlap of 200 to 210 marks in General Studies 2. Coming to General Studies 3. General Studies 3 is largely divided into economics, science and tech, environment and internal security. So, these four aspects cover the General Studies 3 paper. If I talk about the first aspect, which is the economics, in PSIR, we study a little bit about the economic development of India post-independence. What was the Nehruvian plan? What was the Gandhian plan to development? The Nehruvian plan finally materialized and we went ahead with the 5-year plans. What were the 5-year plans? During the 5-year plans, we carried out land reforms. We went ahead with the Green Revolution. So, what were the consequences of the land reforms? What were the consequences of the Green Revolution? These all are very much a part of PSIR as well as has an overlap with General Studies 3 portion. Next is the Science and Technology portion. That does not have any overlap with the PSIR. Next is the Environment portion. Again, that has very limited overlap with the PSIR paper. However, the fourth part, which is the internal security, that has a good overlap with the PSIR. How is that? I'll explain you. In PSIR, we study about the international relations. Let's say if we are talking about India-Bangladesh relationship or the India-Myanmar relationship, we also study about the irritants between these nations. This cross-border terrorism is one area. The insurgency is one area. We study that as a part of the international relations also. And if I talk about India-Myanmar, or if I talk about the region of the Northeast India, there have been many insurgencies in that area. So, this internal security aspect of the international relations can be very well utilized in the internal security. This is the first aspect. Second is the issues like terrorism. Terrorism they can very easily ask a question on terrorism as a part of the internal security, rather they asked a few years back. Now, terrorism as a concept is something which is studied in great detail in PSIR. So that again will become, will have a overlap here in General Studies 3, which finally tends me to say that we have an overlap here also of good 70 to 80 marks. Let me discuss about GS4, ethics part. Ethics part is something whereby you understand about various philosophies, various viewpoints. You know, you read about the thinking of many kinds of philosophers, and then you try to incorporate that ethics in the governance. And this whole critical understanding, which is there as a part of the GS4 ethics paper, is the very starting point of political science when we study the political thought. The political thought starts with what a human is, what he wants, what the society should look like, what the state should do so as to ensure order in the society. So you study the thoughts of Plato, you study thoughts of Aristotle, you study the thoughts of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. Wo sab utilize ho sakte hain very well in the GS4 paper. It depends on you how good you are with the interlinkages, but the groundwork is laid in an extremely well manner in PSIR, which forces me to say that this has an overlap of around 120 to 30 marks and even more depending on how well you can interconnect things. Coming to the last part, which is the essay paper. The essay paper. I'll give you an example of 2017. In 2017, there was a essay. The topic of that was the relevance of non-aligned movement in India, or the relevance of non-aligned movement, something on these lines, but it was essentially about non-aligned movement. Now, non-alignment and the non-aligned movement is the starting point from where we study the foreign policy of India as a part of paper 2. A direct question, a direct topic of the essay. However, you can have direct topics from, you know, other options also, but that is not the point which I am trying to make. In addition to that, when you talk about essay, you talk about themes like, I will write here, democracy, you talk about themes like secularism, you talk about themes like women rights, you talk about themes like federalism, you talk about themes of civil society. All these themes, they are core areas of PSIR, core areas. So I would say yes, the student of PSIR definitely has an edge in essay vis-a-vis the other students, because whatever you study is something which is so much practical in nature that UPSC usually asks questions around those dimensions. You go and check the previous year papers of UPSC, you will come to know about that also. In addition to that, we have these philosophical essays, or the UPSC, what they will do is they will give you an idiom, be the change you want to see in the world, and then they will ask you to write on this. So these kinds of essays are also asked. A student who has good understanding of GS4 is usually able to attempt those essays in a better manner. And yet again I will say, those essays demand critical inquiry. The critical mindset is developed when you analyze what human is, what society is, how the state came into being, again those topics from where we start the study of political science. So the philosophical essays, those idiomatic essays, the students of PSIR, they are able to attempt those essays in a much, much better manner. So this was about the mains part. Let me talk about the personal interview part also. Now, as part of the personal interview, how PSIR helps is it gives you a holistic understanding about a number of topics, international affairs being one of the most. And you might have heard that international relations, international currents is also one of the favorite topics of the interview boards. I'm not saying the other topics are not asked, they are asked, but international politics remains an important topic. However, in addition to that, because of the diverse nature of the subject and the diverse topics which the subject covers, it gives you a very good understanding about many kinds of issues. And because of this, I would say that it will give you an edge in the personal interview round also. This was a little bit about the overlap with the general studies of PSIR as an optional, which I would say is a very important consideration. You should take into account how much is the overlap with the general studies of any particular subject and then make an informed decision. Let me now discuss the last part of the discussion. This is the guidance. The guidance constitutes do you have access to good faculty? Do you have access to good material, books, various kinds of, let's say if I have to talk about political science, I will talk about the websites and the editorials because they are very important for PSIR. The accessibility to faculty, the availability of the material. Please take these things into consideration because you will be staying with the subject for a period of let's say 1.5 years and it is extremely important that you follow a path which has a, you know, which has been guided by someone, and whatever time you invest as a part of the foundation course, you are giving a good 4-4.5 months of the time to the optional subject in the first go, and then you even go for the test series and everything. So it is very important that you make an informed decision as far as the, again, accessibility of faculty is concerned and the availability of the material in the market. And it is here only where we intend to help you also, because we will be coming up with the foundation course for PSIR, the details of which I will be discussing in a separate video. So please stay tuned for that also, those who are interested in taking PSIR as their optional. Having said this, I hope some of your doubts were, I was able to clear some of your doubts related to the subject. This video is a part of the series of videos which I will be coming up, and I will be dealing with the issues related to PSIR in great depth. So thank you everybody for watching and all the very best.